So, shall we get started? Let's ask for God's presence. God, we ask you to be with us today as we discuss the Lord's Prayer, so that we may see new things and old things and be enriched in our prayer life. And we ask all this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, Lord's Prayer was presumably written or spoken in a language called Aramaic, which is somewhat similar to Hebrew, then was translated into Greek, and eventually has been translated into languages all over the world. There is one word in the Lord's Prayer in Greek, and this is the only time this word appears in all of Greek literature. So there's an amazing vocabulary in classical Greek, but the word that doesn't appear, and you all know what it means, maybe, is the word daily. So give us this day our blank bread, and everybody translates it daily, but that may not be accurate. But I'm going to start today and ask you to look at this handout. And the left box is from the book of Matthew, and the right box is the book of Luke. The theory is that when Matthew and Luke wrote their Gospels, they had the book of Mark in front of them. Mark, it seems to be the oldest of the Gospels. So they incorporated most of what he had. And then they had a lot of things that Jesus had said. And so Matthew and Luke seem to share a common source that included, among other things, the Lord's Prayer. Although we will see that it doesn't exactly match, but it's very close. I'm going to read Matthew's Lord's Prayer, and then I'm going to ask you what you notice about this Lord's Prayer in the book of Matthew. And when we have exhausted that, we'll look at the Lord's Prayer in Luke. So let me start. And it says, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one." So you all know the Lord's Prayer by heart. What do you notice about Matthew's version of the Lord's Prayer that might seem a little different?
We say trespasses instead of debts.
Okay, well, that's good. We'll come to that in just a moment. Let's start with the trespasses. The King James Version was based on other Old English translations, especially one by John Wycliffe and William Tyndale, and another by Coverdale, and they all use the word trespasses. So, debts, we are indebted to God because of our sin or because of our trespasses. And we see the signs, no trespassing. And then you pointed out, there's no, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." Over the years, I have gone to a number of Catholic funerals and weddings. And the first time I did that, I was invited to join the Lord's Prayer. And all of a sudden, I found I was the only one speaking. So I wised up after that time and learned you have to stop. But she mentioned there's no thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. You will see if you look at this handout that that sentence occurs in neither Matthew or in Luke. But it shows up in some very late manuscripts of the book of Matthew. So presumably people said you've got to end this prayer in some way with a doxology. And so it was added to Matthew, but not to Luke. It seems to be based on a passage in 1 Chronicles 29, verses 11 and 12, where David is praying, and so this doxology is there, and it seemed to be an altogether appropriate thing to say. Other things you notice as I read.
The tense.
Pardon?
The tense on the forgiveness. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven.
Yeah.
The past tense. And it's a...
It's present tense. Yeah. So, no doubt, the Lord's Prayer was not only written down, but it was prayed. We think it was prayed most by three times a day. And people, therefore, may have adjusted it over the years. But the one in Matthew says, we're not going to ask God for forgiveness if we haven't already forgiven somebody else. So we can't say, God, please forgive us. But I'm still mad at Harry. Huh? You know the old joke about the couple that had been married for 50 years and somebody asked them, what's the secret of your marriage? And they said, we've only had one fight and it's still going on. Anything else you notice about this translation? Yes, sir.
The word amen.
So, in addition to saying thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever, amen. None of that. There actually are 10 different endings to the Lord's Prayer in various Greek manuscripts. But you're right, the word amen isn't there. All right, so it doesn't say anything about whose father. It doesn't say anything about the location of God.
Also, this translation is not the one that we use. We don't say, do not bring us to the time of trial. We say, lead us not into temptation.
Yeah. Lead us not into temptation is a strange prayer, isn't it? Does God test or tempt anyone? Yeah.
But God didn't.
In the story of Abraham's sacrifice of Isaac, in a sense, God tempted him. But when we come to talk about Luther, Luther says, God indeed tempts no one. But this is quite a different prayer. It said, do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from, is it from evil or from the evil one? If it's evil one, it presumably is Satan we're talking about. But what's this business about, do not bring us to the time of trial? Jesus himself says on several occasions that we're very close to the end of the world, and that there was a theory in Judaism that as the world came to an end, people would be put to martyrdom. So is this prayer saying, God, I know tough times are coming. Please don't bring me to the time of trial, or save me in the time of trial. I don't know what Grace's custom is. The congregation I belong to prays the old prayer 1 month and the new translation the next month. And because some people say, oh, it doesn't seem like the Lord's Prayer unless we say trespasses, right? But actually, in this case, the translations are quite different between lead us not into temptation and save us from the time of trial. So if I'm facing martyrdom, please, God, give me a pass on that. Because I don't know if I could withstand that. One of the comments I wrote on this sheet is that there is no reason why a Jew couldn't pray this prayer. There's nothing about the death and resurrection of Jesus. Almost all of our prayers, I presume, in church will say something like, we ask all this in Jesus' name. There's nothing about that. So this is a prayer. I mean, the Jews want God's will to be done. They want God's reign to come. So it's interesting that even that supplement, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever, amen, doesn't really make this more explicitly Christian. Let me read Luke's Lord's Prayer, and I want to see what you observe. Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. I need to remind you, it's kind of a guess that the word means daily. But give us each day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial. So what did you notice? Yeah. So it says, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, but it doesn't say your will be done. And it doesn't add on earth as it is in heaven. Presumably, God's reign is already on the way in heaven. God's name is hallowed in heaven, and we pray that it also will happen here. But you can see we're one short. Anything else you notice?
Forgive
us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. Very similar, but not exact. And nothing here about save us from the evil one. when we think about written texts, even this written text, this is done with a computer, but each copy is identical, right? Unless I really screw up the computer. But a copy of the whole New Testament would require the skins of 55 sheep. Think about that. It makes it a pretty expensive book. You better like lamb chops, too, if you're going to kill 55 sheep to get enough skin for the New Testament. And then you have to hire somebody who can copy that quite carefully. Might take a person a year to do that. So how many people in antiquity could read? Usually said to be less than 5%. And if they could read, could they afford a Bible? So there may be some things here that people memorize, and then when you get to a certain age, you forget. Some of you are smiling. So let's look at some of the things that are said here. God's name should be honored as holy by all people. The second commandment says we should not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God. Your kingdom come, that is, we are asking God's reign to take place in the world. Give us bread. Give us each day our daily bread. Why did people pray for bread? Or what did they have in mind when they prayed for bread? I mean, the obvious thing is they wanted to eat. The substance of life. I give tours at the Oriental Institute at the University of Chicago, mostly the sixth graders. And I would say to the kids, this gets a rise out of them, the two standards of food for the Egyptians were bread and beer. Also for kids. It was kind of watered down beer, but these were the two standards of life. So to say, give us bread, say we got to put food on the table. What might put some urgency to this is that the early disciples of Jesus were quite poor. So to ask for bread is a matter of life and death. But there's a couple other possibilities. People who said, give us bread, might be thinking of the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist, which serves bread and wine. And there's another theory that says there was an expectation with the world coming to an end that God would start up again the gift of manna, as he had done in the wilderness. So when you say, give us bread, were you thinking of that bread, which is a sign of God's new reign on earth? Were you thinking of the bread that you need to keep body and soul together? Or were you thinking of the bread of the Lord's Supper? And the answer, I think, to all those questions is yes. You talk about trespasses. Matthew says debts. Sin is a debt that we owe to God. a debt one cannot repay. And so we ask God for forgiveness. Are we saying, give me forgiveness in the last judgment? Yes. Give me forgiveness today? Yes. Do not bring us to the time of trial. So we've talked, we just looked at the text of the Lord's Prayer in the New Testament. We notice that they are close. I didn't count how many exact, I mean, is Luke 80% of Matthew? And what difference does the translation make? The translation I use is the NRSV, which is kind of the standard Protestant translation of the Bible today. It was prepared in 1989. I suspect many of us grew up on the King James Version. First new translation was in 1946 for the New Testament and 1952 for the Old Testament. Some of you may remember when all of a sudden we have a different version of the Bible. When the Old Testament was published in 1952, it caused all sorts of outrage. Now, a cool person like Saeed wouldn't have done this. But one pastor took a blowtorch into the pulpit and burned it up. I mean, he was really mad. I suspect nobody slept through the sermon, so that was an advantage to that. But as we know, translation is somewhat objective, but it also leads to personal decisions. And people said it was good enough for Paul and Silas. It was good enough for me. When the King James Bible was made in 1611, King James, who wasn't that ideal a person, by the way, some people refer to him as Saint James. Those words would never cross my lips. But he had one thing he said to the translators. There will be no marginal comments. I suspect many of us have study Bibles that have helps at the bottom of the page. King James said, no marginal comments. And the reason for that was twofold. Because the standard Bible at that time was called the Geneva Bible, made not in Geneva, Illinois, but Geneva, Switzerland. And it had all sorts of marginal comments. Some were anti-Catholic. And at the time that King James ruled, England was very much split between Protestantism and Catholicism. But the other kind of comment was anti-king. So for example, you remember the story when the Israelites were in Egypt and the midwives were asked to throw all the baby boys into the Nile River. And because they feared God, they didn't do that. And the marginal comment in the Geneva Bible was, right on, sisters. I'm upgrading it a little bit. And why were the marginal comments happy? Because they disobeyed the king. So King James says, please, no marginal comments. But now, having looked at the New Testament and the modern translations and the difference between Matthew, and Luke, we're going to see what this guy Martin Luther had to say. So Luther had a Bible that says, "Our Father, you who are in heaven." And I'm going to read his explanation, and then I want you to interpret it. With these words, God wants to entice us so that we come to believe he is truly our Father and we are truly his children. In order that we may ask him boldly and with complete confidence, just as loving children ask their loving father. How does that strike you?
That describe Luther's relationship with his father?
That's a good question. Which was not always that peaceful, especially when he says, "I don't want to be a lawyer, I want to be a priest." My memory was that if I wanted something as a kid, I would ask my mother. So Luther, I think, is maybe talking about a different economy. Women didn't work outside the home in Luther's time. The man controlled the money, and don't you forget it. So he said, just as loving children ask their loving father. Now, I appreciate my father. Occasionally, he could get a quarter out of him. But it's interesting how we might be to say, just as loving children ask their loving parents. And in my case, my mother was a much easier touch. Anything about this explanation of Luther that is here?
I like the word boldly.
Yeah. Yeah, so that if you trust God, if you believe in God, you don't have to play games with God. You can say, this is what I need. The other thing that struck me, maybe it doesn't strike you, with these words, God wants to entice us. This is a standard translation of the Small Catechism. This is nothing that I did. But God wants to entice us, to lure us, to tempt us in a sense, to ask God for anything we want. You all happy so far? All right. May your name be hallowed. Hallowed be thy name. Part of the deal here is that the person's name, in the Bible especially, but in antiquity in general, one's name is one's person. Our name is like our social security number, huh? But God's name, God's identity, is to be hallowed. It's to be kept holy. Now I'm going to read what Luther had to say about that. How does this come about, that God's name is holy? It comes about whenever the Word of God is taught clearly and purely, and we as God's children also live holy lives according to it. So God's name is hallowed when we listen to God and learn about God. To this end, help us, dear Father in heaven. However, whoever teaches otherwise than the Word of God teaches profanes the name of God among us. Preserve us from this, Heavenly Father. What's going on there? God's name is hallowed when God's will and God's word is taught, and we obey that. And whenever we teach otherwise than the word of God teaches, that person profanes the name of God among us. What do you think about that?
Does the word hallowed have a connotation of praise or of holy? Because it's two different things.
Yeah, I think it means to be kept as holy, was to be respected.
And holy has a word of different meaning, but it needs set apart for the most part.
Yeah, yeah.
And that means like the flowers on the altar would be holy because they're here.
Yeah.
If they were out in the garden, they wouldn't be. But praise is a little different.
And Luther takes this a particular way. He says, the way we hallow God's name is that we teach God's will. And that way we hallow God's name. And he said, and whoever doesn't teach it that way profanes the name of God.
Do you think he was referring to the Catholicism and all the periphery that it worked with the man as far as the word definitely mentioned in the Bible?
Yeah. So he's saying there's some people in the church who are exposed to the same name of God, but when they teach it, it kind of comes out different than what I, Luther, believe. Now, the catechisms were written in 1529. In 1529, Luther was involved in a big argument on how Christ is present in the Lord's Supper. And some people said Christ is really present in bread and wine. And other people said the bread and wine represents Christ. And Luther had a big argument in 1529, and he said, my opponents were teaching falsely. So I don't know if you ever asked the question, what's going on in Pastor Saeed's life that he brings this up in the sermon? It can cause all sorts of suspicions, right? So none of us are separate from our challenges. I mean, if you were going to preach and you were just got bad news from the doctor, or if you were going to preach and you got bad news from your accountant, it might affect what you had to say. So I think the fact that Luther was writing the catechism in 1529, when there was a huge argument about is Christ really present in the Lord's Supper, and Luther said one thing, and a guy by the name of Zwingli said something quite different. He was from Switzerland. So I think Luther has said, we've got to teach what God says in the Bible. Because this would not be the first thing that occurs to me when I said I want to hallow God's name. I want to respect God's name. I mean, it could be saying, I'm not going to use God's name in a curse. Luther said, hallowing God's name means that we teach exactly what God has had to say. So Luther was not apart from controversy. Everybody okay with that? Yeah, you're not.
How as human beings do we know exactly what God has? I mean, we all are affected by our interpretation,
yeah,
or somebody else who interprets it.
And Luther would have said, well, what does the Bible say?
Well, in terms of that, the, whether Christ is present in the Eucharist, you know, symbolically or bodily, I don't think the Bible tells us that.
This is my body.
Yeah, but how do you understand that?
And in the Aramaic language that Jesus taught, there is no verb is. There is in Greek when we say this is my body, and we think therefore that Greek is a proper interpretation of Jesus' own native language. But you're right, people, well-intentioned people, could answer that question in different ways. Now, 2 weeks from today, 3 weeks from today, we'll look at what Luther had to say about the Lord's Supper, so we can hold that in abeyance a little bit. Give us this day our daily bread.
We skipped one.
I know. I thought I could sneak that by you, but I obviously can't. All right. May your kingdom come. God's kingdom comes on its own without our prayer. God's kingdom here means God's reign on earth. But we ask in this prayer that it may come also to us. How does this come about? Whenever our Heavenly Father gives us His Holy Spirit, so that through His grace we believe His Holy Word and live godly lives here in time and hereafter in eternity. So Luther interprets your kingdom come means that we're brought to faith and we trust God's Word. And it helps us live now and forever. Now I'm going to go skip ahead. Give us our daily bread. I told you, in my opinion, there were probably three things that were thought about in the New Testament. One was, since the world may be coming to an end, I hope God gives us manna, as He did to ancient Israel in the wilderness. Second, we're hungry. We're poor people. And so God give us bread. And thirdly, we say, give us the bread of the Eucharist. You know, when we look at a picture, do we say to ourselves, what was the artist trying to say? Or do we say, what does the picture say? It may not be the same thing. And so when a person prays, give us our daily bread. God gives daily bread without our prayer, even to all evil people. That's right out of the Sermon on the Mount. 3 or 4 weeks ago, the Sermon on the Mount in church said, the sun shines on good people, the sun shines on evil people. So all of us receive sunshine today. Well, of course, we're all good people. But it says, God gives daily bread without our prayer, even to all evil people. But we ask in this prayer that God cause us to recognize what our daily bread is and to receive it with thanksgiving. So many, or even most of us, when we sit down to a meal, ask God to bless this food. We recognize where this food came from. It just didn't come from a TV dinner. It didn't just come from a farmer or from Jewel, but we say it comes from God. But then Luther says, what is daily bread? And he comes up with an answer that astonishes me. What does daily bread mean? Everything included in the necessities and nourishments for our bodies, such as food, drink, clothing, shoes, house, farm, fields, livestock, money, property, an upright spouse, upright children, upright members of the household, upright and faithful rulers, good government, good weather, peace, health, decency, honor, good friends, faithful neighbors, etc. I don't question any of this, but it would never have occurred to me that daily bread includes the governor of the state of Illinois, or my friends, or my shoes, or my livestock. Anyway, Luther is making a pretty wonderful extension of this prayer. Yes, sir.
There was a sermon last year by Dr. Albright, where he thought, but that the Lord said, I am the bread of life.
Yeah.
And so, it's nice to think about Jesus, our Savior, every day.
Yeah.
And that seems to...
So that sermon, I am the bread of life, means that Luther should have said that includes the gift of Jesus. But he's thinking of everything in the household. These are everything we need. And we need more than bread, don't we? We need clothes. We need a place to live. So Luther is trying to help people reflect a little bit about the things that we have, about our bank account, about our friends, our neighbors, who's cooking soup for lunch. So I find this quite rich here, even though I think if I had asked you to say, what does daily bread mean? Most of you would not have come up with such a long list. But now you see this long list, you'll never forget it. So lead us not into temptation. And Luther says, it is true that God tempts no one. But we ask in this prayer that God would preserve and keep us so that the devil, the world, and our flesh may not deceive us or mislead us into false belief. These three things Luther talks about all the time. The devil. In fact, Luther talks much more about the devil than I do. The world. So, what other people are saying, and our flesh may tempt us. So Luther says, God indeed tempts no one, but we are tempted sometimes by the devil, the world, and our flesh, and we ask God not to let those things deceive us or mislead us into false belief, despair, and other great shame and vice. And although we may be attacked by them, by the devil, the world, and our flesh, we may finally prevail and gain the victory. But deliver us from evil. In Matthew translation, it says, protect us from the evil one, namely Satan. But Luther took it more generically, deliver us from evil. We ask in this prayer, as in a summary, that our Father in heaven may deliver us from all kinds of evil, affecting body or soul, property or reputation. And at last, when our final hour comes, may you grant us a blessed end and take us from this valley of tears to himself in heaven. So as we face our death, that's an evil, huh? Could lead to our annihilation. And Luther said, deliver us from evil. Take us from this veil of tears to yourself in heaven. And then he says, this brother over here said, none of those new translations said anything about amen. So Luther said, well, what about amen? What does this mean? That I should be certain. That's interesting. Everywhere else it's talked about we, us, our. Now Luther brings it home to the individual and say that I should be certain that such petitions are acceptable to and heard by our Father in heaven. So I say, amen. I know this is going to happen. For he himself commanded us to pray like this. You know, at the Lord's Supper, I don't know if this happens at Grace, but it happens in my church, we say, and now we pray in the words that our Lord taught us. Our Lord commanded us to pray like this and has promised to hear this. Amen, amen, means yes, yes, it's going to come about like this. So Luther says, you ought to pray with full confidence. You ought to pray asking for forgiveness and assuring God that you've forgiven your neighbor who's such a stinker. You should say, I know that you give daily bread, also to wicked people, but I hope we will recognize what our daily bread is and receive it with thanksgiving. Yes, yes, it's going to come about like this. So that's what I wanted to say, and we have a few minutes to bring up your observations about the Lord's Prayer.
Back when I was doing Spanish many, many decades ago, I bought a Spanish utensil. And it translated, it is not in the tradition, it is a bandanas, not in the temptation.
Huh?
If I can make more sense.
Abandon us not into temptation.
Abandon, do not abandon us in temptation.
Yeah. Good. Yes. The word Father for God is quite rare in the Old Testament, but it does appear. And so Jews in the first century did address God as Father. There's even an Aramaic word that's used, Abba. Some people say that's the same as Daddy. I don't think so. I think it's a term of endearment, but I wouldn't say daddy. But Jews did address God as Father, and they consider themselves as God's children. Yeah, Bob.
During the crucifixion, one of the things that Jesus said, his Father
forgive. Yeah. And Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. So in the New Testament, Jesus, Father, if you will, take this cup from me, nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. So it's a natural thing to address God as Father. A slight majority of our students at the seminary are women. When I first started teaching seminary, which was in a previous millennium, there were no female students. Now they are the slight majority. And a number of these sisters say, why do we always refer to God as Father? Why do we not sometimes refer to God as Mother? After all, God has no gender, does He? So God appears to us as parent, as nurturing parent, sometimes as reprimanding parent. But does God also address us as mother? Yeah.
You know, as you're talking about that, I've always had a very good, when I was a child and I grew up, and as long as he was alive, my dad and I had a great relationship. So God to me always has been very comfortable as a father.
Yeah.
However, many years ago, a few years ago, we were having breakfast with some friends, and she talked about how she had a horrible relationship with her father, and it has always been a problem for her to call God as Father.
Mm-hmm.
It never occurred to me until that conversation that may be something that people are aware of, that they're having trouble naming God as a Father.
Mm-hmm.
So now when you talk about it, that conversation just came to my mind, even though I've never had trouble calling God Father. I don't know why I said that. But
no, I'm glad you did.
I, for one, was raised by just one parent, being the only child, and by my mother. So me for father, even though I didn't have a father in my family or anything else, I always thought father was not, you know, at least in the church and all that. And mother is, to me, sometimes Mother Earth, who gives life from the earth. You know, so it's you can use either male or female, or together, you know.
Yeah. Let me give you an example. Psalm 2, which is a psalm that's talking about the king's coronation. And God says to the king, you are my child. Remember how that goes on? You could probably remember it in Latvian, but not in English, huh? You are my child. It's usually translated, today I have begotten you. It's a rather interesting thing. Today I have begotten you. Begotten is what the man does in the reproductive process, right? So the king is being adopted as God's child. Now what the Hebrew says is, you are my child. Today I have given birth to you. There's not a single English translation that translates it the way I did. But I'm right. You are my child. Today I have given birth to you. So God has no gender, does God? God has no body, even though we talk about the hands and the eyes of God. So sometimes for those people who've had a rotten relationship to their father, reminds us that God appears to us as loving parent. And if it helps you to think of God as loving mother, that might be quite useful. Yes, please.
Why do we think that when we say rescue us from the evil one, that evil one is Satan?
Good question. Could be your next door neighbor who's a stinker, huh?
Well, that I can identify with. I've got great neighbors.
Yeah.
The
ambiguity is it could be from evil, that's the traditional translation, deliver us from evil, taking it as neuter. It could also be save us from the evil one, and it could be somebody who's given you a rough time. I think it's very likely, however, that they had Satan in mind.
What was the history of the personification of a Satan figure?
Oh, that's a good question.
Who is Satan?
Who is Satan?
I mean, really, evil, yes.
Yeah.
But can anybody describe him? Or where did he come from?
Well, he's quite prominent in the New Testament. Jesus was tempted by the devil. Satan is virtually absent from the Old Testament. Except in Job, where he has a definite article with him. He's not Satan, he's the accuser.
Yeah, and he's sort of the devil's advocate.
Yeah.
But then when you say devil's advocate, then I would again ask the devil, who's the devil? We can go round and round with that because we, I find, when you think about it, where did it all come from?
Yeah. Well, I think we all admit there's evil in the world.
Oh, yeah.
And sometimes evil is so pervasive that it seems to have supernatural powers. I mean, why is there war in the world? War is so very unpeaceful. Why do humans want to kill one another and make it permissible under governmental rules? I find this strange. I must say, that Satan doesn't play a very large role in my faith life. I recognize temptations. I recognize my propensity to do evil. But frankly, I don't blame it on the devil.
No, you're not Flip Wilson, the devil.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Back to this father, mother thing.
Yeah.
I was thinking, what other word could have been used instead of our father? I mean, they're referring to the father and looking for wisdom. And so you can substitute wise one. Because most of the time when you're referring to your father in a prayer, I think you're inferring that you're looking for some wisdom from someone else.
Yeah. Jews, when they pray, often say, the Holy One, blessed be He. So they do use the masculine pronoun. But we refer to God as Holy One. It's understandable that we refer to God as parent. That's somebody who's superior to us, from whom we receive protection and nourishment, so to call God parent, I think, is a natural thing. I just think in 2017, we may realize that for some people, only talking about God as Father may be quite difficult. And it might not be difficult in your life. I look back at both of my parents with great love. But I can understand that some people say, when we go to church, why do we only hear about He? And is there a way to make that more inclusive? This may be farther than you want to go. Could you say, our Father and Mother who are in heaven?
One church I was in had a woman pastor, and she explained to me why they changed the words of many prayers and liturgy. Instead of saying God the Father or He, they would just repeat the word God.
Yeah.
It was a little odd because you said God, you know.
Yeah.
But she said because so many of the women in that particular church had been so damaged by their fathers that they just could not pray it the way we always did.
So as I get around, I hear some churches say God the Creator, God the Redeemer, God the Sanctifier. And we avoid the question of gender altogether. Well, my goal here is to help us to understand how the Lord's Prayer came to us, how sometimes use of a more modern translation might open our eyes to new insights. So are we saying God spare us from evil, or God spare us from the evil one? And Luther, God bless him, when he talked about daily bread, he thought about everything under the sun. And who's to say he's wrong? So I'm going to quit. I have a meeting back in Hyde Park I have to go to. You folks get to go to church and have a wonderful lunch. And I'm happy for you. So I hope to see you next week when we're going to talk about baptism as Luther understood it. And I'm again going to ask you, what does your baptism mean to you? What does Luther say about baptism, which is a really important thing? And when I think of what our baptismal liturgy says, it often adds some things. One thing that brings me to tears every time I hear it. Mary, child of God, you have been sealed with the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. I find that just a wonderful line in our liturgy. And Luther didn't mention it. So we'll find the great things that Luther did have to say, and we'll think of things that we would want to add. After all, Luther lived 500 years ago. I think he would change over 500 years. I'll tell you one last joke. This is not a good joke, so if you don't like jokes, turn it off. There was once a debate among the various Lutherans in the United States. If Luther were alive today, which Lutheran denomination would he belong to? And some people said, well, Augustana Synod. Or some people said, LCA. And then the guy from the Missouri Synod said, why would he change his membership? All right, we'll see you next week.